Okay, good evening. Second. Okay, here we go. Good evening, everybody. Tonight we are actually live on Facebook as well as Instagram. And if you're on Facebook, you will see Sister K is here already on Facebook. And we're just waiting for people, a few people to get out. To let them know that we are actually live as well on Instagram, and then we'll ask Sister K to join us there. So as you guys know, it's miscarriage, it's infant loss, pregnancy loss month, awareness month. So we are talking to Sister K about it, where she's written a book, I Never Saw Her Eyes. Love the image in the background. So thank you, Sister K, for joining us. We're just waiting to invite you here, and we'll accept you here. There we go. So whether you've joined us on Facebook or you've joined us on Instagram tonight, we're trying to do both of it. And yeah, so very excited. We're just waiting for Sister K to accept. And then she'll join us over on Instagram and we can start our talk. So Sister K, we're just waiting for you to accept. Here we go. Perfect. We did it. Yay, we did it. Okay, so guys, we are really not like that technical. But we actually managed to do this, both of us. And I think I should just keep my eyes here focused on Instagram. I think that's the best at the moment. So we can see both anyway. You guys can see us. So thank you for joining us again. This is a very big topic. Miscarriage, pregnancy loss. If any of you have ever, you know, I did a story yesterday and I had so many comments. People sharing with me how they've been coping with dealing with miscarriages. I mean, there was one lady that says she's had three miscarriages already. Same as me, I've had three. And I know what it's like to deal with it. And especially when you're dealing with it on your own. It's hard, you know, there's so much things that go through your mind. Like there's a lot of self-blame. There's all these things that happens when you deal with miscarriages or pregnancy loss. So I'm going to, first of all, I think most of you guys know Sister K. I keep saying Sister K, sorry. Kalezo. I like Kalezo.
I love Sister K. So feel free to call me Sister K. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, so we read your book, we spoke about it, but as I explained to you, like, there are so many women, our site grows all the time, our platform grows all the time, and there's so many women that go through it all the time. I mean, it's not like that just doesn't happen once, you know, it just happens now, and then you won't hear anybody. There's so many women that go through it, so these talks are important, right now, somebody could have just found out they've had a miscarriage or something, and they're going through that pain of dealing with it. It's indescribable if you've been through it. So thank you very much for doing this, joining us, and trying to do this crazy thing with me. We're doing it on both platforms, but thank you that you accepted. And thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much. I must say, I feel like I'm very tech savvy now. I am on Zoom, I am on Facebook, and I am on Instagram all at the same time. So yeah, awesome. You've made me a techie.
awesome. So tell us about what made you, what is it that you do, first of all, and then what made you start, what made you actually write this book? Tell us your story.
Yeah. Okay, so let me start with the story, which then leads to the point where I decide, let me put this down on paper, you know, so that a book can reach where I can't reach. It can reach places that I've never been. So I thought that's one of the reasons why it's so important to write our stories, because our stories are so powerful and they are so far reaching when written, because the written word can reach places places where physically I may never be able to. So having been married and having dreams of a big family, in 2018, my husband and I started to try for a baby in 2017, actually, and we got successful pregnancy, and I carried my daughter for a whole 39 weeks, only for her to be stillborn for reasons unbeknown even today to all the doctors I have consulted. So it's still a mystery even now. And following that loss of my daughter at 39 weeks, also having had subsequent miscarriages, more than one, all in the first trimester, I found myself at a place where I really had to deal with grief and face it and go through the process. And by the grace of God, I can say that I was able to successfully deal with the grief and get over what had happened, not get over it, but be able to live with my reality and still live, you know, a great life and still have a great marriage. So when I was seeing, especially, you know, in the first wave of COVID in 2020, a lot of people were going through grief and not knowing how to deal with the severe loss that all came at the same time, loss of loved ones, loss of life as we knew it, loss of jobs, loss of businesses, just people just dealing with pain of loss in all different spheres, even women and couples also losing pregnancies amongst all of that. And I found that nobody was really talking about, you know, having a miscarriage in the middle of a pandemic, because it seemed like there's so much greater losses that everybody else is going through, that I suppose even when you were going through a miscarriage during all of that, you sort of felt bad about talking about it. But I thought, you know, the responsible thing to do would be for me to share my story and my journey, hopefully just with that hope of encouraging someone who was going through loss. Yes, loss of a pregnancy, loss of a baby. But as it turned out, you know, with books, they just take a life of their own. I just found the feedback from people having been, I'm going through loss, I'm going through a divorce, and I'm finding that I can relate with the book. I lost my job, I'm relating. So it's really, the essence of it is how to effectively deal with the pain of loss. And I just wanted to do my bit to help, because I was seeing that people all around me were really, really struggling. But with regards to pregnancy loss, that there wasn't really a voice of pregnancy loss, even during the pandemic, because people were just dealing with so many other losses, and that seemed to get lost somewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. But how did you, do you maybe want to just touch on your story a little bit more, like, you know, what you went through and how you dealt with, how you coped with it? You know, like, as I'm sitting here, I'm thinking about, I don't want to use the word reminisce, because it was a bad time. And I'm thinking of exactly, I actually like picture myself laying there and in a ball crying, unconsolable. Like, what did you do in that time? What went through your mind, and how do you cope going, how do you move forward from there?
From that, I think because I've got so many stories, you know, I could talk about what I went through during the loss of my daughter who I lost at 39 weeks. I think maybe because I started my introduction with pregnancy loss during COVID, maybe I can just talk about the miscarriage that I went through during a hard lockdown, because that was just one of the loneliest times that I've ever had in my entire journey, my fertility journey. Even with the loss of my daughter before, I could say it was better in a sense that I had my husband with me every moment throughout the pregnancy. I had him going with me to the doctor's appointment. But with the subsequent pregnancies that happened during COVID, just while everything was still fine, as an example, he was not allowed to go with me to see my gynae for my consultations, one. So whenever we'd go and see my gynae, he would be in the parking lot waiting for me because he wasn't even allowed in the hospital. Visitors were not allowed. You're not allowed to have anyone who is not a patient. Quite lonely. Up until the day I went for a scan and I was told that there is no heartbeat. I was alone. My husband was in the car. So it was just double extra hardship because now I have to go out and go and tell him what's going on, because the doctor told me what's going on and she told me the options. I could have an evacuation or I could take some tablets and let it happen when my body responds, when I'm back at home. So I mean, you are shocked, you are disillusioned, you cannot believe that this is happening to you again. And on top of that, you still have to be the bearer of bad news to your partner. So that is just trauma upon trauma. So on that particular day, I actually had to go and I went to the parking lot and I said to my husband, this is what the doctor says, there is no heartbeat. And for us, unfortunately, it was not the first or the second time we were hearing such. So it was devastating. You go into a period of denial, you go into a period of anger because you can't understand, why does this keep happening to me? You know, so it's different from the first time. It's, why is this happening to me? Then it's, why does this keep happening to me? And you're frustrated as well because you're also not getting answers medically. In my case, none of the doctors can say, this is what we feel is wrong, this is how we can change, or this is treatment we can put you on, nothing. So it was very difficult. But I think,
sorry, but it really affects your spirituality also as well, don't you think?
Like, that's one of the first things that get attacked. Where is your God when you are going through all of this? And I think as much as the spiritual element of it is a challenge initially, for me, it was the exact thing that helped me to get through it. 'Cause you asked me a question, how did I get through it? And for me, I got through it because I refused to accept that it just happened and there was no purpose. So my attitude towards my fertility journey is that there must be a purpose behind it. And if the purpose is that so that I'm able to share my story to help the next person, then so be it. And with regards to my relationship with God, I had to be honest and say, okay, so am I only a Christian that is happy with God when things are going my way? Or am I going to keep professing my faith even when things are not going my way? So for me, the answer was, you know what? I love God irrespective. What is happening to me, I may not fully understand it, but I have to trust that there is a bigger plan and God has a purpose for me. So that's why I was able to move out of the pit of despair, anger, and pain and start embracing so what now? What can come out of this? And that's why we have a book. We have me talking to you as an example. All of this wouldn't be happening if I hadn't gone through what I went through, or if I did go through it, but I didn't seek to find meaning and purpose. So in essence, I just chose to make the lives of my babies count and have meaning.
Awesome.
They were not conceived in vain. They were conceived for a purpose. Yeah.
Wow, I love that. It's beautiful. I see someone just saying in agreement, this is the case, especially if God allowed it. Amen. That's absolutely beautiful. And I'm actually hearing what you're saying with regards to, you know, there has to be a purpose. There's a reason why things... It's difficult for me to say that, and it's difficult to tell people, you know, there's a reason why things happen. And I never like saying it at all. I don't like using those words to people. And especially when they're going through grief, just having a loss, and like the worst thing you can tell somebody, oh, everything happens for a reason. That's the last thing anybody wants to hear. And I mean, I heard it like, oh, it happens for a reason. Don't tell me that. I was super angry at the world at that moment. And which brings me to the next question with you, to you, is how do you deal with someone else? If you the other person on the outside, what do you tell that person? How do you help someone else move? I think when we're going through infertility and going through miscarriages, pregnancy loss, the loss of an infant, what do you on the other side, we always have these friends also in the same circle. We tend to have friends in the same circle, you know, and if one of our friends are going through something like this, what do we tell them? How do we help them also, you know, move through things, not say past it, but move through it?
Yeah. Well, to answer the question, the short answer is you can't. And thinking that you can actually causes more harm than good. Because once you step into a mode of, I am going to help my friend get through this, then you tend to be just a little bit extra on everything. Because when you tell them something encouraging, you expect them to respond in a way that shows you are doing a good job. So actually there is not much that we as humans can do to help or get somebody through grief. But what does help a grieving person, though, is to know that they are not alone. It's to know that they have people who are also hurting because they are hurting, people who care about their loss, and that if they need to talk, the people are there to talk. If they need any kind of practical assistance, especially immediately after the loss, if they need help with errands, that there are people who are available, who avail themselves to do that. So in terms of what you can do and what you can say, I would say that you have to acknowledge the loss, you know. So don't pretend that nothing happened. Acknowledge the loss and say, I acknowledge that you have lost your baby. I don't thoroughly understand what it must feel like. So don't even try to pretend like you know what they are going through, because you don't. Even if you've had your own pregnancy loss before, people react to loss differently. We all come from different contexts and circumstances, so it can never be the same for everyone. So acknowledge the loss. Tell the person how you feel about it, because you can't know how they feel about it. So things like, I know how you feel, they're probably not very wise things to say, but to acknowledge that I may not fully understand how you are feeling. However, this is how I'm feeling about the loss. And then to let them know that you are there for them. And, you know, something I say in my book that some people always laugh about is, I, you know, the statement, if you need anything, let me know. I actually don't like that statement because it depends on our relationship. You know, if my mother tells me, if you need anything, let me know, it's fine because I know she literally means anything. I know I can borrow money from her. I know I can ask her to come help me out at the house. If I had children, I would know that I can ask her to help me with the children. But if our relationship is not that solid that I actually understand what you mean by anything, you are leaving me with the burden of deciding what every anything means. So I always say, if you want to support someone, you know what you want to do for them. If, for example, they've lost a baby and there will be a funeral, you know that probably family will be flying up to where they are staying. You can offer to pick up their family members from the airport. You know that they might have a little bit more guests than usual. You can offer to host some of their family members that are attending the funeral. When you go and do your shopping, you can call them and say, I am going to buy a few items. Would you like me to get you something? I'm taking my children out if they've got other kids. Don't mind picking up your children so that they can spend the day with us. So when it comes to that, I really advise people to be practical and not just to say, if you need anything, let me know, because then it's the burden on the person that is going through the grief to decide what kind of help they need. And when you're going through grief, that's like a very difficult thing to answer.
Yeah. You know, it makes me think what happened when I told one of my best friends that, you know, what had just happened to me. And she came through, she stopped everything she was doing. She came through to me, came with a bag of chocolates and chips and you name it, all of my favorites. And she's like, we're just sitting here and we're going to eat. That's all we're doing, you know? And that I think is more just having that person there. And I'm just loving your advice that you're giving. And I think that is the worst when someone says to you also is, oh, let me know if you need anything, like, you're going to give me my baby back. You know, you're almost in that space where, and you know, I might be, you know, saying something and people are like, oh, how can you say that? But that is actually what you're thinking. Mm-hmm. You know, you're so angry at the world and angry at everybody. And someone says that to you and immediately your mind, that little person in your mind is saying exactly that to that person, not saying it directly, but, you know, that is what you're thinking. So I completely understand why you're saying don't say that to somebody. Do actual things, you know?
Correct. And because, you know, when you're going through grief, it's almost like if you've got red glasses on, you process everything through those red glasses. So if you are not the one who's bereaved, you might be seeing green and you might be saying what you are saying from the most beautiful space with the greatest intentions. But because I filter what you are saying through the lens of grief, I hear something else. And I love what your friend also did. I call it the ministry of silent presence. Even when you are there, just be quiet. If you don't know what to say, chances are nobody knows what to say in any case. And you don't have to say anything actually, but just let me know that you are there. I say there's a line in my book that says Job appreciated a mute button on the Zoom session, because I was just talking in the context of the pandemic that, you know, some people can't come out and physically be with you, but it's almost like but they can, you can have a Zoom session and the mute button can be on. And yeah. I am happy because I know you are there. So don't shy away, because some people, because they don't know what to say, they'd rather stay away completely. So I say, take away the burden of wanting to say something. You don't have to say something. Just be there and let the person know that you are there. And it does wonders.
Yeah. I don't know if you'd mind answering this question. We've got a question from Jeshuel.
Jay Twelesa. My question is, how do you help someone who went through the same to stay hopeful that it's going to happen one day, just not now? Well, I think there is understanding the difference between not yet and never. You know, sometimes just because you get a not yet, it doesn't mean that it will never happen. Like myself, as an example, I'm still in that waiting camp. You know, I haven't given up. I've gone through the most, but I am still trusting that God will give me my children of promise. Yeah. He knows my prayers, and I haven't given up hope. So I would say keep the faith, keep trusting God, he will come through for you. But also, I also want to say, you know, there's a scripture that says none shall be barren in the land. Actually, if we were to think about it, Mary had Jesus only with the Holy Spirit. You could say it was IVF.
Yeah.
You could say Jesus Christ was born out of IVF. So yeah. I also want to say to Christians that having a biological baby yourself is not the only way to have a baby. So we should also be open-minded enough to explore other options like IVF, like adoption as an example. So when it says none shall be barren in the land, it doesn't mean that all will have a baby through natural childbirth. Yeah. That's not what the Bible says, but you can have children in other ways. So I also wouldn't tell somebody who's had 50 miscarriages to keep trying. You know what I mean? At some point, it's not in your best interest mentally, psychologically, or physically to keep trying. But I would just say, seek God and get from God the best course of action, but there is definitely ways of getting children even if you don't have them biologically yourself.
That is a very touchy subject, and for those of you who don't know, I've actually got two beautiful babies. I have a four-year-old and I have nine months old, a little girl, and I've Both of them came in, came to us through adoption. You know about them, Sister Kay. And you know what? I would never push it on anyone. I just feel in my case, it was meant to be. But I would never ever push it on anyone and say, you know, don't try. It's up to you. It differs for everybody. It's definitely a subject I want to talk about. I want to bring it up. As in have a talk about adoption and options there are and things like that. But I would never actually push it on anyone, because it's up to the person on the other end. If you ever want to speak about adoption to me, or ever's listening, fostering, adoption, please DM me. I will be happy to discuss it with you. Even if you check on my personal profile and stuff like that, you'll see I've absolutely, maybe it's eyes of the beholder, but I my babies are beautiful, and they, I always say, born for me and not from me. So yeah.
and that's your testimony, that's your children that are God given to you. So I also think it goes down to redefining what motherhood is and what womanhood is. Because for some reason, we've defined motherhood as having a biological child. And I don't subscribe to that definition, because even I myself, I am a mother. You know, my husband's got two children. They are my children. I don't even refer to them as my stepchildren. I mentor a lot of children, even in my family, some of them I really, really have taken them on as my children. So I'm a mother, whether or not I have given birth, it's of no bearing, but the point is we need to redefine what motherhood is, because we seem to have a skewed understanding of what motherhood is and what womanhood is in general.
Yeah, wow. And I remember correctly, you have a big family, am I right?
I come from a family of 5 children. Yeah. So like I said, my husband has 2 children. So I was saying, God, in my marriage, I'm going to have 3 so that we have 5, just like I had growing up. So now my prayer to God is like, okay, God, I've been pregnant enough times. So now I should be pregnant just one more time and let me have my triplets so that I'll be done.
Yeah, wow.
Thank you. I haven't reduced the numbers expected. Absolutely. I've just reduced the number of pregnancies.
Yeah. You never know. So thank you very much for this talk. And so Sister Kay has a book called I Never Saw Her Eyes. And it's about her journey. I read it a while ago. And it's from the first page, it's already gripping and you already take things out of it. So like the first, going through the first chapter, you already, you know, these things that makes it you don't want to put the book down and stuff. So if you guys really want to get it, you can actually contact her directly or DM her on Instagram or Facebook, or to a Facebook page, or you can actually buy it through our website as well. You go to Fertility Products or Fertility Solutions and you can actually go through our store and purchase it there.
Somebody is asking for a picture of the book. It's actually this on the background.
Yeah, it's in the background. So that's the book. And can you give us the price of it as well?
It's 180, it's retailing for 180, and obviously excluding delivery, we do deliver throughout the country. So if you get it from me, delivery is only 80 rand. So for 260, we can deliver wherever you are in the country. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so very much for doing this. And again, it's so very important, especially to how to deal with it, how to cope with it, because the whole month we're going to obviously talk about miscarriages and how to deal with it. So this was a really, really good talk. And again, thank you for doing this whole new thing for Instagram and Facebook at the same time. I just found that this was such an important topic. There's so many women on our platforms, especially on Facebook, and I wanted to be able to give them at least this, you know.
So sorry, Leanne. So I see another comment there. Somebody is asking, what about us outside of South Africa? The book is also available on Amazon if you are outside of the country. So you can get it via the Amazon platform. You can either get it ebook or a paperback. There's options there that you'll find on Amazon.
Okay, thanks, Ola. That's Ola from Fertility Conversations.
So thank you for joining
and thank you for always being an ambassador for women dealing with infertility. Thank you very much. So thanks, guys, for joining us tonight. I really appreciate it. Thank you, Sister Kay.
Thank you so
always
much.
Always lovely having you. Always lovely chatting to you.
Yes, keep well
and we chat soon.
Cheers, and bye to everyone on Facebook as well. It's been great having you guys as well. And of course, the ones on Instagram.
All right, perfect. Thank you very much. Bye.
Yes, bye.